Welcome to Cantle of Joy Ministry online service. We are glad to have you today. And by the grace of God, we continue with the series, Roll Away the Stone. So the first stone that we talked about it was the stone of intimidation. And now we are dealing with the stone of shame. Now this is the third part in our message. But the second, when it comes to the stone of shame. So last Sunday, we talked about shame, and we saw five areas in our life where shame affects us. So today, we'll be dealing with how to roll away the stone of shame. So by now, you are probably saying, all right, Pastor, I understand the problem. I know what it means to feel shame, to live with shame. So what is the solution? How am I going to deal with this shame? How am I going to roll away the stone of shame? So children of God, we're going to see a couple steps how to roll away the stone of shame. So number one step, acknowledge your shame. Number one step, acknowledge your shame. So children of God, you do not effectively deal with shame by denying it. You cannot effectively deal with shame by ignoring it. You must boldly acknowledge your shame. You must boldly admit your shame. You cannot blame your inherited sin. You cannot blame your inherited sin nature for your shame. You cannot blame others for your shame. You cannot blame circumstances for your shame. Because if you do this, shame will continue to characterize your life. If you do this, shame will continue to characterize your responses, your relationship. So you must fearlessly confront shame before you can act, before you can roll away the stone of shame. So, children of God, we need to understand that shame is like a signal, is a signal that something is wrong. For example, when you are driving a car and you see an angel light appear on your dashboard, when you see a light, it means that something is wrong. So you have two choices. Either you come out of your car, you open the hood and try to see what's wrong with my car, or you just ignore the light, you continue driving. But guess what? You will stop one way or the other. And you might even burn your motor. So children of God, shame is a signal that something is wrong. So you don't ignore it. You need to acknowledge. So this is the first step for you when it comes to roll away the stone of shame. Now here, we're going to read the example of King David. He admits, he acknowledges his shame. Luke Psalm 32, verse 3 to 4. Psalm 32, 3 to 4, or 3 to 5, please. Psalm 32. Look what the Bible says here. When I kept silence, my bones waxed old through my roaring all the day long. For day and night, thy hand was heavy upon me. My moisture is turned unto drought of some Selah. Now, look verse 5. I acknowledge my sin unto thee, and my iniquity have I not hid. I say I will confess my transgression unto the Lord, and thou forgave the iniquity of my sin. Selah. So, we have here a clear example. David admits his shame. So, in order for you to roll away the stone of shame, you have to admit, you have to know that it's there. Don't deny it. Don't ignore it. Because every sin has its associated shame. So for every sin, you have shame. Now, as long as you do not acknowledge and deal with your sin, you will never be free from its associated shame. Hallelujah. Now, children of God, David was confronted. He was confronted by Prophet Nathan. Nathan confronted him. Now, look the response of David, 2 Samuel 12, 13. 2 Samuel 12, 13. Look what the Bible says here. And David said unto Nathan, I have sinned against the Lord. And Nathan said unto David, the Lord also hath put away thy sin. Thou shalt not die. Remember, because if they catch you in adultery, like the case of David, they will kill you. They need to stone you to death. But here he acknowledged his shame. So children of God, we need to acknowledge our shame. Even Jesus, so shame. Look with me, Hebrew 12, verse 2. Hebrew 12, verse 2. So this is the first step. Don't ignore it. It's there. Don't ignore it. Look here, Hebrew 12, verse 2. Looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him, endured the cross, despising the shame, and he sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. So Jesus went to shame. The cross is more powerful than your shame. The cross of Jesus is more powerful than the shame. So Jesus took your shame to the cross. So when Jesus died, he died for our sins. He bore our sins and he bore our shame. So you don't have to die for sin anymore. You don't have to die for shame anymore. It doesn't matter if it's inherited shame, individual shame, incessant shame, imposed shame, or institutional shame. You don't have to. Why? Because Jesus died on the cross and bore your sin and bore your shame. So you don't have to bear it anymore. Look here what the Bible says here in Romans 10:11. Thank you, Jesus. For the scriptures say, whosoever believe on him shall not be ashamed. Because Jesus bore already your shame. So as long if you believe in him, when you give your life to Jesus, Jesus become your Lord and Savior, no longer you will bear shame. So this is step number one, to roll away the stone of shame. Step number two, act against your shame. Act against your shame. And acting against your shame means that repent of everything that produces it. Repent for everything that produces that shame. True repentance is an inward decision that results in the outward act of turning away from sin. This is true repentance. Repentance is not only you going before the Lord God, Father, I'm sorry I did this. No, that confession. But repentance, you turn away from your sins, children of God. You turn away from that bad habit. You turn away. So you repent from the things that produce shame. Look here, Psalm 38, verse 18. Look what the Bible says here. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. For I will declare my iniquity. I will be sorry for my sin. This is David speaking here. Now, children of God, look at, for example, Apostle Paul, he repented. He repented. The man put Christian, persecuted Christian. He even witnessed, he supervised the death of Stephen. But the man repented, and God used him, and he became the advocate of grace. So, children of God, you need to know that once you acknowledge, then you act against it. You repent from everything that produces that shame. Children of God, look at the woman who was caught in adultery. When Jesus forgave her, he said, go and sin no more. Change the way of living. Change. Children of God. So, number one, you acknowledge. Number two, you repent. You act against it. You repent, children of God. Don't just confess. You need to repent. You need to change your way of living. Be conformed to the word of God. Live a righteous life, children of God. Step number three, address your shame. Address now your shame. After acknowledging your shame, after acting on it, you must address now your shame. Now, true John of God, Jesus bore your shame on the cross. So you don't have to bear it. But after you repent from everything that produces shame, there is a voice that's going to continue to speak to you. There is a voice that's going to continue to speak to you. But when you hear the voice of shame speaking to you, address it instead of ignore it. The voice of shame will speak to you. Don't ignore it. Don't deny it. You're not going to silence it by deny it. You're not going to silence it by ignore it. Because you're going to keep on speaking unto you. The voice of shame. But children of God, you respond to that voice of shame. Use the word of God to respond to it. Say, I do not receive that. For Jesus, who knew no sin, but bore my sin, he bore my shame, so that I can stand righteous before God through him. Children of God, even if you are guilty, like the woman caught in adultery, don't listen to the voice of shame. But listen to the voice of your Savior. Listen to the voice of Jesus. That voice does not speak condemnation, but that voice speaks conviction. Look here. Hear the voice of Jesus. Look here. John 8:11. Look the Bible. Look what Jesus says here. She said, we can start even verse 10. When Jesus had lifted up himself and saw none but the woman, he said unto her, woman, where are those thy accuser? Had no man condemned thee? Had no man condemned thee? She said, no man, Lord. And Jesus said unto her, neither do I condemn thee. Go and sin no more. Go and sin no more. So, children of God, address your shame. Speak to that shame. Speak back. Speak back to the voice of shame. Don't ignore it. Don't ignore it. Otherwise, if you surrender to shame, it will have the same effect that it has on Judas. And we know that when Judas betrayed Jesus, Judas was ashamed. And Judas died in his shame. You don't have to die in your shame, children of God. You don't have to die in your shame. Why? Because Jesus already died on the cross and bearing your shame, bearing your sin. So you don't have to die for your shame. You don't have to. Look what the Bible says here. Psalm 31, verse 1. He said what? In thee, O Lord, do I put my trust. Let me never be ashamed. Deliver me in thy righteousness. When you are in Christ, you're never gonna be put to shame no more. When you are in Christ, why? Because Jesus bear your shame. So you have to tell the spirit, the voice of shame, I cannot bear you no longer, because Jesus bore you already on the cross. So children of God, address shame. Address shame. Step four. What you do after you acknowledge shame? What you do after you acknowledge shame? What you do after you act against shame? What you do after you address shame? You abandon shame. Abandon shame. Now you must abandon shame. And how you abandon shame? You must abandon the sins that cause your shame. The sins that cause your shame. Children of God, you cannot just confess your sin. You cannot just say, Father God, forgive me because I was stealing. Yeah, he forgave you, because the Bible says in 1 John 1:9, if we confess our sins, God is just and faithful to forgive us and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. But you don't have to keep repeating the same confession every day. You need to make a U-turn. You need to change. You need to repent. Change. Abandon. Stop what you are doing. Now, children of God, look what the Bible is telling us here. Oh, glory to God. We're going to read now here, 2 Peter. We're going to hear 2 Peter. So you need to stop. 2 Peter 2. 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 20 to 22. Peter 2, 20 to 22. Now, look what the Bible says here. For it after they have escaped the pollution of the world through the knowledge of the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. So you escape the pollution of this world through the knowledge of the Lord. Once you know the Lord as your Savior, look at what the Bible says here. They are again entangled therein and overcome. The latter end is worse with them than the beginning. Why? For it had been better for them not to have known the way of righteousness than after they have known it to turn from the holy commandment delivered unto them. But it is happened unto them according to the true proverb, the dog is turned to his own vomit again, and the sow that was washed to a wallowing in the mire. So you see here, he said the pig go back to the mat and the dog go back to the vomit. And now when you hear this message, when I talk about vomit, some of you just burr. But yes, but you go back to the same vomit. You go back to the same vomit. As a child of God, you don't go back to the same vomit. You need to abandon the things. Abandon, leave away, keep it, leave away, stay away from sin. The thing that produces shame. You cannot confess and you're still living in shame. You cannot confess before the Lord God, you're still living the life of adultery, a life of fornication. No, children of God, God cannot be mocked. God cannot be mocked. If you know that you're not going to repent, don't go on your knees and ask for forgiveness. You cannot ask for forgiveness and continue doing the same thing and keep on confessing. No, children of God, this is playing religion. This is playing with God, and nobody can play with God. The blood of Jesus is there, is our provision. It cleans you from your unrighteousness. So that your relationship with God is back to normal. But it does not mean that you confess and you keep living. No, my people, which are called by my name, if only they turn away from the wicked way. Turn away, we mean what? You abandon, you leave it alone. Children of God, that the only way you can roll away the stone of shame. Otherwise, you're gonna keep living in shame. Why? Because shame is attached to sin. As long as you are living in that sin, you will bury that shame. Children of God, can nobody lie to you? Can nobody lie to you? Individual shame because of the decision you made, you commit sin. Now, children of God, you commit sin, but here you are, you want to remain living in sin, but you don't want to face shame. No, it doesn't work that way. Step 5. Ask God for a renewed relationship. Ask God for a renewed relationship. Ask God for a renewed relationship. Ask God to give you a passion for Him. The only way you will get out from under shame dominion is through a renewed, intimate relationship with God. Peter denied Christ. He denied Jesus 3 times. He denied Peter 3 times. And Jesus told him before, Peter, the devil is sifting you, but I have prayed for you that when you're gonna come back, because he knew that he would fall, he said that, but you're gonna strengthen your brethren. He denied Jesus. What a shameful life of a disciple. The one who was ready to die for Jesus. The one who walked on water. The one who said, I will never let everybody deny you. But when it comes to me, I will never deny you. Jesus said, chill out, Peter. You will deny me 3 times. And here, he denied Jesus 3 times. The man was living with shame. Everybody was looking at him. He said, I can't believe, Peter, you deny Jesus. I can't believe, Peter. He was living with that shame. And Jesus appeared to him. And Jesus asked him 3 times with increasing levels of intensity. Do you love me? Yes, I love you. Do you love me? Yes, I love you. Do you love me? The man broke in tears. Why he broke in tears? Shame. Why he broke in tears? Shame. But the same Peter repented, made a U-turn. Look at his life later on. The man developed now a new relationship, a new union with Christ, with Jesus. The man was so anointed that people, when they knew that Peter was passing, they take all the sick people, the lame people, they lay them down on the street so that the shadow, not Peter touching them, only the shadow of Peter can touch the sick and they recover. Which type of anointing is this? Which type of anointing is this? Why? Because he repented. And the man had now a renewed relationship with Jesus, with the Lord of Lords, with the King of Kings. Children of God, this is what you need. A new relationship. A new relationship. Look here. The prodigal son. He shamed himself. He shamed his father. He shamed his own family. He shamed his community. But this prodigal son, he denied now. When he was living now a shameful life, when he was living in shame, he did not ignore shame. He did not deny shame. He acknowledged shame. The Bible says he came back to himself. He acknowledged shame. He acted upon shame. He acted upon it. He addressed it. Because every single thing about him was screaming shame. The man began to eat the pig's food. Shame. But here, he decided to go home. And he went home empty-handed, full of shame. But his father was waiting for him. Your father is waiting for you. God is waiting for you with open arm. Children of God, don't die in your shame. Don't die in your shame. Jesus already died for your shame. He died for your sin. You don't have to die in your shame. Suck it up. Swallow your pride. Come back to him. And stop living the way you are living. Come back to him. He loves you. You don't have eternity on earth. God loves you. Come back to him. Children of God, come back to him. And the prodigal son, he came back. His father hugged him. And they clothed him. And he received feast. He was the guest of honor. Because the father loved him. He loved him. Children of God. This is what you have to know. There is no, look what the Bible says here. Oh, glory to God, glory to God. Come back to him. Renew that relationship with your father. Look what the Bible says here. Romans 8 verse 1. There is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh but after the spirit. There is no condemnation when you are in Christ. When you are in Christ, there is no condemnation. Children of God. Here he went back. Don't let shame influence your identity. Don't let shame cover your identity. Know who you are. Know who you are. The same Romans 8. Look here, verse 15. For ye have not received the spirit of bondage again to fear. Don't fear shame. But ye have received the spirit of adoption, whereby we cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit itself bear witness with your spirit. The Holy Spirit who dwell in you, he bear witness with your spirit that you are a child of God. Nobody will tell you, but the Holy Spirit within you, he speak to your spirit and he convince you, and you know that you are a child of God. And if you are a child of God, then you are heir. You are heir of God and joint heir with Christ. If so be that we suffer with him, that we may be also glorified together. Children of God, oh, you should rejoice. You are not co-heir, you are joint heir. He said, the Bible said that the moment you accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior, you receive the spirit of adoption through which you cry, Abba, Father. Children of God, and the Holy Spirit who is in you, the Holy Spirit bear witness with your spirit. And you know deep inside you are a child of God. And if you are a child of God, you are heir of God. Not only that, you are joint heir, not co-heir. Co-heir means if you have 100%, you will split 50% for me, 50% for other. Like other people, when they get married, 50% for the wife and 50% for the husband. No. Joint heir means if we have $1,000 in our account, the same right the husband has on that $1,000 is the same right the wife has on that $1,000. So the man has 100% right upon that money. And the woman has 100% right upon that money. This means joint heir. So wherever God gave Jesus, you are also partaker of it. Every blessing, every single thing they release unto Jesus. That's what the Bible says, that we die with him and we rose with him and we sit with him at the right hand. Wherever Jesus is, that's where we have to be. Wherever Jesus has, that's what we have. Children of God, this is called love. This is called love. And that's why we have the millennium. So wherever Jesus receive and Jesus will enjoy, you and I also gonna enjoy with him. Children of God. So God's acceptance and grace banishes shame. Children of God. Only God's opinion matter. Children of God. And God declare you worthy. He want to conquer shame more than you do. God is on your side. Shame will terrorize you. But children of God, the love of God, the love of God, the love of God will free you. Now, children of God, I want you to renew your relationship with God. I want you to renew your relationship with God. Children of God, ask for renew. So, how to roll away? How to roll away the stone of shame? Children of God, when you renew that relationship, God is a God of second chance. God is a God of second chance. Don't just sit in your condition and begin to blame yourself. Don't just sit in your condition and begin to blame people. Don't just sit in your condition and begin to blame circumstances. God is a God of second chance. He gave second chance to many people. He gave second chance to Samson. He gave second chance to Peter. He gave second chance to Paul. And you are no different. God will give you a second chance. Children of God, many people let shame, let the shame of the sin and the failure prevent them from fulfilling the God-given destiny. You have to fulfill your God-given destiny. Refuse to let shame control and dictate your future. Refuse it. Don't let shame prevent you from fulfilling your destiny. And how you do it? By rolling away the stone of shame. How you do it? You acknowledge your shame. Why? Because if you don't acknowledge, shame will keep you prisoner of your past. And you will not gonna fulfill. You will not embrace your destiny. How you do it? You roll away. You roll away by acting against your shame. Repent from any bitterness. Repent from any unforgiveness that you may harbor against those who cause you shame. Address your shame. Abandon shame. Ask for renew. Children of God, my prayer. Pray. Say, Father, I repent of everything in my past. And in the present, that generates shame. I no longer bear my sin. I no longer bear my shame because it's on Jesus and his righteousness is upon me. Give me a new intimate relationship with you, Lord. And if you do so, children of God, I decree and declare, every chain of shame shall be broken in your life. Every chain of shame in your marriage shall be broken. Every chain of shame in your destiny shall be broken through the precious blood of Jesus. It doesn't matter what you did in the past. It doesn't matter what people say. It doesn't matter they impose shame. It shall be broken, children of God. It doesn't matter the source of your shame. It shall be broken. Hallelujah. It shall be broken. It shall be broken. Children of God, look here. Look here what the Bible says. Jeremiah. It shall be broken. You don't have to live with shame. Shame of your marriage. Shame of your family. Every type of shame. No, you don't have to live in shame. You don't have to live in shame. You have a destiny to fulfill. You have a future to fulfill. Children of God, don't remain in the past. Don't remain, don't be a prisoner of your past. We all do have past. But children of God, you also have a future. Look in front of you and embrace your future. Look here, Jeremiah 40, verse 4. Jeremiah 40, verse 4. Look what the Bible says here. And now, behold, I loose thee this day from the chain which were upon thy hand. Gee, God is speaking. He said, Jeremiah, I loose you this day from the chain which were upon thy hand. If it seem good unto thee to come with me into Babylon, come. And I will look well unto thee. But if it seem ill unto thee to come with me into Babylon, forbear. Behold, all the land is before thee. Whether it seem good and convenient for thee to go, go. Children of God, God is not setting you free just for the sake of setting you free. No. God set you free because you have a destiny. You have a mission to fulfill. You have a purpose. The thoughts that He has taught you, they are thought of good and peace, not of evil, to give you an expected hand. You don't have to live in shame. You don't have to sleep in shame. You don't have to die in shame. Some of us, you wake up in shame, you walk in shame, you live in shame, and you go to sleep in shame. This is not the life that the Lord God ordained for you. No. That's what the Bible says. When you are a cross, you become a new creature, children of God. Every single thing about you needs to change and need to change for better. He set you free. He said the chain that were upon your hand, I break them so that you can go. Go with me. It shall be well with you. The land that is before you, I give unto you, children of God. He free you from shame. He bore your sin. He bore your shame so that you can live a life of victory. And that's what the Bible says, in all these things, you are more than a conqueror. Victory is yours. Live a life of victory. Victory in your marriage. Victory in your family. Victory in every area of your life. Children of God, you have to fulfill the plan that the Lord God has for you. That's the reason why He set you free. And remember, the devil will try to return with accusation and attempt to resurrect your shame. This is what the devil does. This is what the devil does. When you forget about it, he will bring it back to your memory. You will hear again the voice of shame. You will hear the voice of shame. But children of God, the moment you hear the voice of shame, immediately reject it and declare, no, my sin and my shame are upon Jesus. His righteousness is upon me. I reject every accusation. I reject your accusation and I accept God's second chance for my life. Children of God, this is how you have to behave. This is how you have to answer. Otherwise, you're gonna keep hearing the voice of shame and you're gonna live with shame all your life and you're gonna die in shame. Look here, the book of Joel chapter 2 verse 26. Joel chapter 2 26. And ye shall eat in plenty and be satisfied and praise the name of the Lord your God that had dealt wondrously with you, and my people shall never be ashamed. And my people shall never be ashamed. Children of God, this is a promise from Almighty God. You shall never live again in shame. Believe it. Believe it. And how you roll away that shame, the stone of shame, when you silence the accuser, yes, he will speak unto you. Yes, he will tell you, oh, remember what you did. You are a bad person. Remember what you did. You are a bad person. You are a bad person. He's gonna speak to you. But children of God, silence the accuser. Silence him. We need to understand that we have two forces at work. Two forces at work in this universe, which are operative, children of God, both in heaven and on earth. Two forces. We have two forces. One force Look at this one force. For example, Revelation 12, 10. Revelation 12, 10. Look what the Bible says here. And they overcame him. They overcame him. Who is that him? The devil. By the blood of the Lamb and by the word of the testimony. And they love not their own lives. Now, children of God, if you read here, verse 10 say, and I heard a loud voice saying in heaven, now is come salvation and strength and the kingdom of our God and the power of his Christ. For the accuser of the brethren is cast down, which accused them before our God day and night. Children of God, day and night. That is man. I just accusing you. Day and night. So we have on one side Satan, the accuser of the brethren, and accuse the brethren before God day and night. And on another side, on the other side, we have another force. So we have one force, and we have also another force. Look at this other force. Romans 8:34. Romans 8:34. Look what the Bible says here. Romans 8:34. Who is he that condemn? It is Christ that died, yea, rather, that is risen again, who is even at the right hand of God, who also make intercession for us. So, children of God, we have two voices. One voice accuse you, another voice intercede for you. Hallelujah. Now, you will conform to the spirit of either one of them, and it will affect you personally. It will affect your attitude toward others. It will affect the word of your mouth. Children of God, Jesus silenced the accuser when he died on the cross because he bore our sin and he bore the shame of the whole world. So by doing so, Jesus silenced the accuser. When you accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior, the devil can no longer accuse you. But he knows. He's still gonna come and accuse you. He's still gonna come and accuse you. And he's gonna lie to you. He will put doubts in you. These are the lies of the devil. These are the lies of the devil. He will put doubt in you. So the first thing, he put doubt in you. And this is what he did with Eve and Adam. Did God really say, if truly you are the son of God, turn this stone to be bread. If truly, so he wants you to doubt about the fact that you are a child of God. If truly you are a child of God, why you are sick? If truly you are a child of God, why you are living failure after failure? If truly you are a child of God, why you are living defeat after defeat? If truly you are a child of God, why? Why is this? This is the lie of the devil. And children of God, many, they are buying into the lie of the devil. And that's why you're still living in shame. No, children of God, you don't have to live in shame. Look what the Bible is telling you here, Hebrews 10:22. Hebrews 10:22-23. Let us draw near with a true heart. Draw near your Father with a true heart, in full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled from any evil conscience and our body washed with pure water. Let us hold fast the profession of our faith without wavering. For he is faithful that promise. God is faithful. So children of God, don't fall into temptation. Don't fall into the lie of the devil. He come with doubt. So children of God, don't fall for it. See, this is how the devil is working. When he lied to you, because Satan does not want you to reach your full potential. He knows that you are a threat to his kingdom. He knows that you are a threat to his kingdom. And he knows that you have been created for the glory of God. You have been created to show forth the glory of God. And that's why he does not want it. He wants you, he does not want you to reach your full potential. He does not want you to complete God's plan for your life. He wants you to fall short of your destiny, fall short of your glory. Children of God, I want you to know that the Lord God created you, and the Lord God purpose a work for you, that you should walk in, and the devil wants to prevent you. But children of God, that work was ordained before the foundation of the world, was ordained before you came here. Jeremiah, before I put you in your mother's womb, I knew you and I set you apart as prophet. Children of God, this is what you need to understand. The devil is coming after your destiny. The accuser will accuse you. You will hear that voice every day of your life. He will tell you, you are too young. You are too immature. But remember, when God called Mary, when God chose Mary to be the mother of his son Jesus, she was young. When David defeated Goliath, he was young. So don't hear the voice of shame. Don't hear the voice of shame telling you you are too young. Don't hear the voice of shame telling you you cannot make it. Don't hear the voice of shame that is telling you it is over. It is not over until Jesus say it is over. Children of God, for your future is bright, and he died for that future and is releasing that future. You walk in it. You are not too young. Mary was young, but it did not stop God from using her. David was young. It did not stop him from defeating the giant. Children of God, you will hear the voice of the devil telling you you are too old. Look at Moses. He spent 40 years of his life in Egypt. He received the best education. And he knew that God chose him to deliver his people. He killed one Egyptian and he ran away from his life. For 40 years, the man now was living a shameful life, running away for his life, taking care of the sheep of his father-in-law. And the devil constantly reminded him and speaking shame unto him. Look at you. Look at you. You are the one. You know, I killed many children. And you, they pick you out of the water and they raise you in the house of Pharaoh. Look at you. He spent another 40 years in the wilderness, living in shame. Living in shame. But at the age of 80, God still used him. So you are not too old. You are not too old, children of God. Look here. Look, some example here. Look here. Exodus 3:10. Don't fall into the lies of the devil. Exodus 3:10. Look what the Bible is telling you here. Come now, therefore, I will send thee unto Pharaoh, that thou may bring forth my people, the children of Israel, out of Egypt. This is God speaking to an 80 years old man. But look at the response here. Exodus 4:11-12. Look here. And the Lord said, because he started giving. Now Moses here had listened to the voice of the accuser for many years, for 40 years, that he had a whole list of excuses. That when God called you, God, you think that people will believe me? You think that people will believe that I heard from you? What is the proof? And by the way, I don't know how to speak. Look here now, God say, 11. And the Lord say unto him, who had made man mad mouth? Who had made man's mouth? And who make the dumb or deaf or the seeing or the blind? If not I, the Lord? Now therefore go, and I will be with thy mouth, and teach thee what thou should say. See, children of God, you start looking at yourself. This is what shame is doing. This is what shame is telling you. And God is telling him, he said, hey, You did not create. I, the Lord God, I created, and I will be with you. I will empower you. As I call you, I will empower you, and I will use you. So, children of God, be like this man at the beautiful gate. When Peter says, silver and gold I don't have, but one thing I have, in the name of Jesus, rise up and walk. Rise up from that shame. Let your family rise up from shame. Let your ministry rise up from shame. Let your marriage rise up from shame. Let your destiny rise up from shame. And begin to walk. Walk in victory. Walk in breakthrough. Walk in your miracle. Walk in your calling. For the glory of Almighty God. For the glory of Almighty God. I'm closing. I'm bringing it to an end. From the glory of Almighty God. Roll away the stone of shame. Roll away the stone of shame. You are not made for shame. You are made for glory. You are made for glory. The Lord God wants, the devil wants you to remain in shame, because he knows that when you are in shame, you don't have strength to glorify the Lord God. When you shame, you don't have that boldness to come before God. Look at Paul. He said, I come before the Lord God. I don't reproach myself of anything. Really, Paul? Really, Paul? You don't reproach yourself of anything? After you persecuted the children of God, after you supervise the death of Stephen, you have the God to say that I don't have any reproach before the Lord God. Yes, this has to be your attitude. For the Bible says, in Christ now, there is no condemnation. Jesus took away your sin. Jesus bore your shame. God sees you through the righteousness of Jesus. God sees you through the blood of Jesus. This is the power of the blood of Jesus. This is the power of the blood of Jesus. When God looks at you, he sees Jesus through you. Children of God. And that's the reason why we can go boldly before him. Because we are covered with the blood of Jesus. Be bold, children of God. Be bold. Don't live in shame anymore. You know, we have many types of shame. Shame because you did not succeed in your life. Shame because you lost your job. Shame because you divorced. Shame because of many things. But don't let it characterize your life. And I know when you already repent, the voice will come and speak again. Try to resurrect shame. No. As the devil tried to resurrect it, bury it again. Bury it again. Children of God. Bury it again. And I'm telling you here, the liars of the devil, doubt. He does not want you to become what the Lord God created you to be. And children of God, we say that we have two voices, two forces, one that accuses, another one intercedes. And the devil is the accuser of the brethren. When you are living in shame, shame begets shame. He wants you to be the accuser. He wants you to adopt also his attitude to be the accuser. But children of God, you don't have to be the accuser. You have to strengthen they that are feeble. You have to strengthen they that are weak, children of God. And the question I will ask, will you cover me? Will you accuse me, or will you intercede for me? And that the things that we are doing when we find somebody in shame, we don't intercede for the people. We criticize them. We laugh at them. We make fun of them. Because they are in shame. This is not the right attitude. Look here. A clear example. Genesis 9. We know the story. Genesis 9. I'm bringing it now to an end. Genesis 9. Verse 20 to 21. Look what the Bible says here. And Noah began to be an husbandman, and he planted a vineyard, and he drank of the wine, and was drunken, and he was uncovered within his tent. Now here, the man who found grace in the sight of the Lord God, the man who found favor in the sight of the Lord God, he had a vineyard, and the man drank wine, and the man was drunken in his tent. Now, look what happened. Verse 22. And Ham, the father of Canaan, saw the nakedness of his father, and told his two brethren with that. And Shem and Japheth took a garment and laid on upon both the shoulder, and went backward and covered the nakedness of the father, and the faces were backward, and they saw not the father nakedness. Hallelujah. Now, children of God, picture this. Ham saw the nakedness of his father. Because the father was drunken, he started making fun of his father. He started laughing at him, making fun of the shame of his father. And from there, Noah cursed his seed. He didn't even curse him. He cursed his seed, the Canaanite. And that's where people said that where black people came. But this is another message. So he cursed. He was making fun of him because he saw the nakedness of his father, the shame of his father. But look here, the two brothers, when they heard it, they took a garment, lay on the shoulder, and they start to walk backward, and they cover the nakedness of the father. And this is the question: will you cover me? Children of God, sometimes God will allow us to see, to view each other carnal flesh. To see each other carnal flesh. And to see our response. Will you be the accuser or will you be the intercessor? Will you be the accuser or will you be the intercessor? The accuser say, look at this man. Look at the father. He was so anointed. But look at him now. He's drunk and naked. But the intercessor will cover you. Children of God, as you listen to this message, God wants you to choose your side. Not the side of the accuser, but the side of the intercessor. Intercede for one another. Intercede for your brother. Intercede for your sister. Intercede for your wife, for your husband, for your children, for your father, for your mother. Intercede for them. Don't just look at him and look at her and say, that is problem. That a problem. Now she's living shame. Now he's living shame. Children of God, don't be the accuser. Be the intercessor. Intercede. Intercede, children of God. And look here, Proverbs 10:12. Look what the Bible says here. It says what? Hatred stir up strife, but love covered all sin. Love cover all sin. Here, Shem and Japheth, they cover the nakedness. So love cover. Love cover shame. Love will cover shame in your family. Love will cover shame in your ministry. Love will cover shame in your marriage. Love will cover shame. children of God. Intercede, but don't be the accuser. Intercede, don't be the accuser. And the question to all of you that listen right now, will you cover me? Will you cover your marriage? Will you cover your family? Will you cover your ministry? Children of God, instead of accusing, cover with love. Cover with prayer. Intercede, children of God. Intercede. And this is what the Lord God wants. Intercede. Now, for those of you, of those of us, as they are interceding for you, you need to change. You need to change. You need to rise up from it and walk uprightly. And finally, once you roll away the stone of shame, you will receive double. That's what the Bible says, for your shame, you shall receive double. Children of God, after you roll away the stone, now I'm bringing it to an end. Look here, Jeremiah. Oh, glory to God. Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Now look here, Jeremiah. Chapter 3, verse 24. Jeremiah 3, 24 to 25. Look what the Bible says here. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. For shame had devoured the labor of our fathers. From our youth, the flocks and the herds, the sons and the daughters. For shame had devoured the labor of our fathers. From our youth, the flocks, the herds, the sons and the daughters. We lie down in our shame. And our confusion cover us. For we have sinned against the Lord our God. We and our father from our youth even unto this day. And have not obeyed the voice of the Lord our God. So here we see shame plague God's people from the youth. He marked the life of the son of the daughter and afflicted the livelihood. So the flags, they heard, they were continually tormented by shame. Shame was with them. As I said before, they wake up in shame, they walk in shame, they talk in shame, and they sleep in shame, and they rose up in shame the next morning. So it was a cycle of shame. But children of God, in the midst of all, in the midst of all, they receive what? In the midst of all, they receive what? They receive a promise. Look here, Isaiah 61, verse 7, really quick because I'm bringing it to an end. Isaiah 61, verse 7. Look what the Bible says here, Isaiah 61, verse 7. For your shame, ye shall have double, and for confusion, remember, they said they were in shame and confusion. And for confusion, they shall rejoice in the portion. Therefore, in the land they shall possess the double. Everlasting joy shall be unto them. Everlasting joy shall be unto them. Glory to God. Hallelujah. So, children of God, you see here, God promised them. Hallelujah. He said, for your shame, you shall receive what? Double. Hallelujah. Isaiah 54. Isaiah 54, verse 4. Isaiah 54, verse 4. Fear not, for thou shalt not be ashamed, neither be thou confounded, for thou shalt not be put to shame, for thou shalt forget the shame of thy youth, and shall remember the reproach of thy widowhood no more. So, children of God, God here is telling you, if you roll away the stone of shame, and for that shame, you shall receive double. Every single thing you lost through shame shall be restored double to you. Wherever that was destroyed to shame shall be restored unto you double. Hallelujah. So the Lord God will restore double unto you. Finally, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Jesus. So the Lord God will restore double unto you. So children of God, You don't have to walk in shame. The last scripture, Zechariah chapter 9, verse 12. Zechariah 9, 12. Turn you to the stronghold. Ye prisoner of hope. You were prisoner of shame. You were prisoner of shame. Now you are prisoner of hope. Even today do I declare that I will render double unto thee. So children of God, you do not have to die in your shame. Be now prisoner of hope. Hope for a better tomorrow. Hope for a better future. Hope for healing. Hope for deliverance. Hope for breakthrough. Hope for grace. Hope for peace. Hope for joy. Be prisoner of hope. Don't be prisoner of your shame. For the Lord God deliver you from shame. Roll away the stone of shame and be what the Lord God call you to be. Roll away the stone of shame and have and possess what belongs to you in the mighty name of Jesus, in the precious name of Jesus. Let the voice of the Lord God speak unto you. Let the voice of joy speak unto you. Let the voice of peace speak unto you. The voice of rejoicing, the voice of breakthrough, of miracle, let it speak unto you and lift you out of shame and lift you out of the shame that you are going through, and rejoice and live with boldness and live in the glory and the power of Almighty God in Jesus' precious name. Children of God, if this message has been a blessing unto you, please share with others so that they might be blessed, so that they might also come out of the shameful life and live the righteous life and live the victory that the Lord Jesus already won for us, and He wants us to live in it. May the Lord God richly bless you. Amen.